Thank you, colleagues. We are actually running quite early on business, but we'll move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on International Women's Day 2021, hashtag choose to challenge. Can I invite all members who wish to contribute to this debate to press their request to speak buttons? And I call on the Cabinet Secretary, Shirley-Ann Somerville.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In a year where we have had precious little to celebrate, I'm delighted to have this opportunity to recognise the amazing achievements of women across Scotland. We all owe an incredible debt of gratitude to our health and social care workforce, the vast majority of whom are, of course, women. They have been on the front line in our battle against COVID-19, and they are leading our recovery, administering the first doses of vaccines to over 1,688,608 people as of today. They have worked tirelessly under intense pressure to provide the best possible care. Their efforts are nothing short of heroic. That's why we have allocated £5 million to enhance wellbeing support services for health and social care staff, and we have also provided a thank you payment of £500 to health and social care staff to recognise their extraordinary work. I also want to express my appreciation to the women across Scotland who have had to juggle childcare commitments with other responsibilities as schools and childcare settings were shut to control the spread of the virus. That's not to say that men haven't had to do this too, but we know that caring roles still predominantly fall to women. According to research from the Institute for Fiscal Studies, in different gender couples, women do considerably more childcare than their partners. During the first lockdown, mums were doing childcare for more than 10 hours each day, on average, along with 4 hours of housework. I have heard from many women about the guilt they felt as they struggle with homeschooling, maintaining a happy, healthy family, and holding down paid work where possible. In fact, that probably does sum up my experiences, Presiding Officer, over much of the past year as well. Our mental health is just as important as our physical health, and I think we all need to be kind to ourselves and to each other regarding what we can do in these extraordinary times, although I would also admit I'm not that great at following that advice myself. But from one mother to many other mums across this chamber and beyond, I want to say thank you and tell you what you have been doing is amazing but hard. And we are dealing with unprecedented circumstances, but we hope those times will soon come to an end. While I extend my sincere thanks to women across Scotland for their essential efforts, I also want to recognise the inherent unfairness that women have had to bear the majority of these impacts. The pandemic has shone a really harsh light on existing gender inequality in our country and how deep-rooted gender biases restrict opportunities for women. The extra caring responsibilities that women are doing is having a profound impact on their ability to take on paid work. When combined with the pandemic's impact on areas of the economy where mainly a female workforce is, such as tourism and hospitality, COVID-19 threatens to undo much of the progress we've made towards women's workplace equality. And we must and are taking actions to mitigate this. That's why we've prioritised the reopening of early learning and childcare because of the crucial role that it plays in supporting children and families. That's why we remain committed to the rollout of 1140 hours of free high-quality childcare for all 3- and 4-year-olds and have provided councils with £567 million of additional funding in the draft budget to support it. We're also reviewing the actions within our Fairer Scotland for Women Gender Pay Gap Action Plan to ensure that they remain fit for purpose and support women through the economic recovery from COVID-19. And in November last year, we launched a new Women Returners Programme and an updated Workplace Equality Fund. The Women Returners Programme will support women who have had a career break back into work, and the Workplace Equality Fund will encourage employers to invest in advancing in their diversity and inclusion practices. Presiding Officer, myself and the Cabinet Secretary for Communities and Local Government established the Social Renewal Advisory Board to consider how we can emerge from the pandemic a fairer, more prosperous Scotland. The board brought together equality experts, third sector stakeholders and local government to provide advice to the Scottish Government on putting equality and human rights right at the heart of our recovery. That work is essential to ensure that we emerge from this pandemic, that we haven't lost any of the gains that we've made, and also that we need to do more to end the inequality that caused them to exist in the first place. I'd really like to thank very much the board for all their hard work in that. We are considering the recommendations carefully, and Ms Campbell and I will respond in due course to their report.
Neil Findlay.
You passed too quickly on health before I could get the intervention, so forgive me. One of the excellent things that the government could do in the week of International Women's Day is to announce that they will fund mesh-injured women to travel to the US to have full mesh removal. Will the Cabinet Secretary advocate for that within the Cabinet, within the budget, so that women who need that service and who cannot get it in Scotland can get that paid for by the NHS?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I recognise the work that Neil Findlay has done on this issue over many years, and he knows that this is something which the Health Secretary is looking at very closely. She wants to be able to work with the women, and indeed work, as I think she has done across the chamber, to bring these events to a satisfactory resolution. And I'm sure she'll continue to work with Mr Findlay and the women on this and deliver that as she goes forward, or if her successor goes forward, whoever that Health Secretary will be after the election. Presiding officer, the pandemic isn't just impacting women's ability to take on paid work. During the pandemic, referrals to services for women and girls experiencing violence and abuse rose. I am deeply concerned by this and want to be very clear that violence against women and girls will not be tolerated. We are working to ensure frontline services continue supporting adults and children experiencing gender-based violence. And that is why last year we allocated an additional £5.75 million to organisations including Scottish Women's Aid and Rape Crisis Scotland to ensure services could meet the increased demand. These are just a few of the ways in which women have been particularly impacted by the pandemic. More impacts are emerging, and we are working closely with stakeholders to identify and mitigate them as quickly as possible. But we cannot be content with simply mitigating inequality. This year's International Women's Day theme is Choose to Challenge Gender Inequality, and we must challenge the systems and the biases that enable gender inequality to persist. Sure.
Elaine Smith.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Minister for taking an intervention. I hope that she would agree with me that that also needs to include challenging the systems in this Parliament, because we are seeing younger women, women with families particularly, feeling that it's not such a family-friendly workplace as it had set out to be in 1999.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as someone who has had two children and did not get any maternity leave for the time when I had those children, I absolutely take on board the point that you're making. I also think, actually, we've probably maybe hyped up how family-friendly we were right from the start, and perhaps we're finding out that, actually, we don't live up to the hype that we've actually set ourselves up in this Parliament. And I think that's a responsibility for all of us to work on. I recognise that things have moved on in some aspects since I had my children, but we are still seeing a number of ways in which we as a Parliament could do better. And I'm sure that's something that the whole Parliament could reflect on as we come back next time. So on the issue of challenging gender inequality, we have taken action across government to choose to challenge gender inequality at its very core. Last year, a UN study indicated that 90% of people hold at least one bias against women in relation to politics, economics, education, violence, or reproductive rights. That is why we've commissioned Zero Tolerance to develop a model for a What Works Gender Institute to choose to challenge harmful attitudes towards gender equality in Scotland. I am delighted that they will publish their results on the 8th of March, and I look forward to moving into the next phase of this work with them soon. We are choosing to challenge gender inequality in education through the work of the Gender Equality Task Force in Education and Learning, chaired by the Deputy First Minister. The task force are developing key interventions and actions to further embed gender inequality in all aspects of our education system. And we are choosing to challenge gender stereotypes in the media too, through funding for Gender Equal Media Scotland to research sexism and gender inequality in the media and to make recommendations on what future work could be undertaken. Much of this work has stemmed from the recommendations of the First Minister's National Advisory Council on Women and Girls, and what they have recommended over the past 3 years is to be highly commended, and I would thank them for all their work. As the International Women's Day theme states, we must choose to challenge gender inequality, but we must also choose to challenge ourselves to do more. The First Minister established the National Advisory Council on Women and Girls to do just that, to be a critical friend in the Scottish Government and to challenge us to be bolder in our actions to progress gender equality. In their 2019 report on policy coherence, the Advisory Council made recommendations on how the Scottish Government can better ensure gender equality is considered in the design of every policy, the calculation of every budget, and the implementation of every service we provide. As part of our response, I'm delighted that we established the Directorate for Equality, Inclusion and Human Rights in December last year to bring increased status to equality and human rights in the Scottish Government. One of the priorities for the new Directorate is the development of a renewed, ambitious mainstreaming strategy. The mainstreaming strategy will incorporate the recommendations made by the National Advisory Council of Women and Girls as part of wider work to weave equality and human rights into all the Scottish Government does. Presiding Officer, as I end, can I take this opportunity to also say thank you to some of the women who will be leaving Parliament at the end of this term, particularly my Cabinet sisters, Rosanna Cunningham, who has dedicated public service over many years, both in the Scottish Parliament and at Westminster. Jean Freeman might have only served one term, but what an impact she has had on the establishment of Social Security Scotland and through the COVID crisis. And of course, my friend and colleague Aileen Campbell. The thoughtfulness, the kindness and the compassion that Aileen shows when she determines her politics is something I think we can all reflect on and something we should have more of in politics rather than less. And it is sad to see her go. But on that sad note, Presiding Officer, on that sad but reflective note, Presiding Officer, can I thank all the women who have contributed to this past session of the Scottish Parliament and everything that they have achieved, and I look forward to hearing from them today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Can I say that the minute and second hand display will start working now, not that it was a problem for you, Cabinet Secretary, and it's really to assist members. There is some time in hand, but I know you get anxious if you don't know how much time you've used, but there is some time in hand. So this won't affect Ms Hamilton, who's at home. So I call Rachel Hamilton, please, to open for the Conservatives, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to be opening for the Scottish Conservatives today on International Women's Day. And like others in the chamber, I am committed to ensuring that harassment, sexism, misogyny, and discrimination against women is rooted out. Instead of paying lip service, we should be delivering meaningful change. Which is why this year's theme of Choose to Challenge is more important than ever. Today, I choose to challenge inequality, ending domestic violence, and calling out gender bias. This last year has been more challenging than ever for women and girls. Pressures on employment, caring responsibilities, education and finances have all been disproportionately affected women, exacerbating already deep ingrained inequalities because of COVID. Dr. Sarah Rees, the head of research and policy at the UK Women's Budget Group, highlighted that women started this crisis from a position of economic disadvantage. Furthermore, women tend to be more exposed to the risk of catching COVID through the sectors they work in. 77% of frontline workers are women, and this poses significant risks. In gender and other women's organisations have highlighted the multitude of ways COVID-19 threatens to roll back women's inequality. It has been estimated by the UN that women's equality is due to be set back by some 25 years. If we look at the employment picture, we can see why this is the case. A woman in Scotland is twice as likely to be made redundant as a result of COVID as a man because of the structural differences in their life circumstances. HMRC statistics show that in most countries and regions of the UK, more women than men were furloughed at the 31st of July last year when the first wave of unemployment occurred. And I welcome the announcement in the budget to extend furlough until the end of September. Yesterday, the UK Chancellor also extended the self-employment scheme for a further 600,000 people who were previously excluded from claiming it. Important for women because since 2008, 58% of newly self-employed people have been women. As we turn to recovery for young women, for the first time, employees aged 23 and 24 will be able to earn a national living wage of £8.20. But we must remain committed to a clear and concise plan for recovery to protect jobs in key sectors, particularly for women. Moving on to domestic abuse, an integral message of International Women's Day is an end to end all forms of violence against women and girls. Yet it remains a distressing fact that in today's society, domestic abuse persists across the world. Worryingly, domestic abuse is on the rise in Scotland. The latest domestic abuse statistics in Scotland show that the number of incidences recorded by Police Scotland has been rising in the last 3 years. We know that domestic abuse is not always physical violence, but it can manifest as coercive and controlling behaviour. And financial abuse remains a huge issue that can be unnoticeable to friends and families of the victim. Women's Aid published their Economics of Abuse report in 2019, which found that nearly a third of respondents said their access to money during the relationship was controlled by the perpetrator. Further to this, over two-fifths of all respondents felt the abuse had negatively impacted their long-term employment prospects. Having spoken to Borders Women's Aid, my fantastic local women's support charity, I see the great work they are doing to provide support, advice, and a safe space for women. If I'm lucky enough to be re-elected, I want to help them access a longer-term funding and look into increasing access to more single-person accommodation. In summing up, perhaps the Cabinet Secretary could address what the Scottish Government is doing to assess the impact of lockdown on domestic abuse and look at funding allocation, which will improve local services and fund refuges going forward. Lastly, I want to briefly touch on the work of the UK government, which is improving equality. Take, for example, women's pay and employment. The UK Conservative government has overseen a record low in the gender pay gap pre-pandemic. In 2019, the UK's gender pay gap for all employees fell to 17.3%, down from 27.5%. That was from when the survey first began in 1997. We introduced the regulations, which mean all large employees must now report their own gender pay gap data. It was also the Conservative government that introduced shared parental leave, and from April 2015, both parents in the UK been able to have parental leave following the birth or adoption of a child, allowing up to 50 weeks of leave, 37 weeks of statutory pay between them, in place of maternity leave and pay. And there is undoubtedly more work to be done as we emerge from COVID. We've got to make sure that we accelerate that narrowing of the pay gap and do more to place women at the heart of our COVID recovery. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I want to close with some words from Mrs. Anderson, the founder of the COVA project in Australia, helping girls who are experiencing poverty and disadvantage due to a lack of financial resources and access to basic necessities. She said, "Feminism isn't about making women strong. Women are already strong. It's about changing the way the world perceives that strength. And with this year's theme of Choose to Challenge in mind, let's challenge damaging and negative perceptions about women in order to change and show that very strength." Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Hamilton. I now call Lane Smith to open for Labour. And this is Ms. Smith's last speech in the chamber. Never thought I'd be saying that, Ms. Smith.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I draw members' attention to my register of interest with regard to my breastfeeding bill and trade unions. The theme for International Women's Day this year is, as we know, Choose to Challenge, to celebrate women's achievements, raise awareness against bias and take action for equality. And action is still needed since we have not achieved sex equality in society, banished misogyny or elected a 50-50 chamber here. I want to reflect on that as I open for Scottish Labour in my last speech after 22 years serving as an MSP and one of the 99ers. And I'm pleased that my sisters Joanne Lamont and Polly McNeill are also going to be speaking in this debate today. Over two decades ago, Labour achieved significant women's representation for the new Scottish Parliament by taking radical positive action in our own selection procedures. And in my own original candidate interview, I noted that in 1918, the suffragettes won votes for women. 80 years later, 82% of MPs are men. Those numbers have improved a bit, but it's clear what a critical mass of women representatives does to make a difference in tackling sex-based inequality and delivering legislation that just would not be a priority for men. Issues like breastfeeding, period poverty, childcare, domestic abuse and the whole spectrum of violence against women, including trafficking, prostitution and pornography. Recent controversies around funding decisions on women's aid refuges and services reminds us that women fought long and hard for specialist services for women and children suffering from abuse at the hands of violent men. And sadly, those services are needed even more during this pandemic. Violence and the threat of it continues at home and abroad, in war zones with brutal sexual violence against women who dare to defend their sex-based rights, such as the shocking hanging of an effigy of Spanish Deputy Prime Minister and feminist Carmen Calvo, and online through threats and name-calling experienced by feminists right across the parties in this chamber. We must choose to challenge all of that. Presiding Officer, turning to action for employment equality, I first saw what sex discrimination at work looked like as a young woman, equality trade union rep, working at a council. The vast majority of women at that time were employed in the low-paid clerical and admin grades, and there was an all-male cast of chief officers. I realised then what many feminist labour and trade union women already knew, that women would have to fight relentlessly for every advance in their jobs, wages and conditions to keep the sex-based rights that they have already achieved. And that's an age-old story. Coatbridge poet Janet Hamilton, a working class woman born in 1795, didn't learn to write until she was 50, and then she let rip. Here's an extract from her poem, The Lay of the Tambour Frame, about women's work. Why quail my sisters, why, as ye were abjects vile, when begging some haughty brother of earth to give you leave to toil? It's tambour you must, not else you have to do, though pauper's dole be of higher amount than the pay oft earned by you. Presiding Officer, over the last year, much of the public engagement in this building, which has enriched our experience as MSPs and informed our decisions, has gone. Being able to bring in community groups to support third sector projects, to learn about campaigns, to meet with trade unions and to work with cross-party groups. This Scottish Parliament really must get that engagement back. The Women's Dinner that I host in Parliament has heard from a diverse range of women campaigners over many years, including young women tackling discrimination over bra size prices, which they won, and the very serious issues of the importance of women-only spaces, as discussed recently with ex-Cotton Vale Governor Rona Hodgkiss. Women MSPs have attended that event on a cross-party basis, and I'm hoping that my good friend from way back before we were MSPs, Rhoda Grant, will host these dinners in future and also might consider taking forward my right to food bill if she's re-elected, so no pressure. Presiding Officer, public services on which women depend both as workers and service users have been lost along with a collapsing community infrastructure. So building back better must mean fair work, including sustainable, flexible working policies and packages and meaningful equality impact assessments. In addition, academic and statistical evidence confirms what the Cabinet Secretary said at the beginning, that women in Scotland have faced a disproportionate impact of COVID-19. This has been in areas such as homeschooling, unpaid caring, job losses and food insecurity, to name a few. We know that women remain underrepresented in public life, are paid less than men, endure violence at the hands of men and suffer disproportionately from the effects of poverty and the unequal distribution of wealth and power. However, we also know that women will come up with solutions, as we have always had to do. This pandemic has also imposed great challenges on our next generation, with UN Women estimating that the pandemic will set women's equality back 25 years. My niece Olivia and my son's partner Charlie, both nurses working at the front line. My niece Emily, a young graduate, adjusting to home working. And my wee goddaughter Cassie in P7, being commended for her online schoolwork. These young women are Scotland's future. It's important that they and all of our next generation of women know of the women who went before them, paving the way forward by fighting for women's rights, for equality and against sex discrimination. Those rights were hard won, they must not be given up. So choose to challenge. We don't have a choice, nor does the next generation, because if we don't challenge, our rights will disappear. Presiding Officer, before I close, it's traditional in a last speech to place on the record some thanks, so I hope I may do that. I want to start with all the people who work in this Parliament, and in particular, I want to thank the staff who supported me when I was Deputy Presiding Officer. Adele Black and the staff working with me recently as Labour's Business Manager, my election agent Barbara Diamond, my local party, and all my own staff and members and volunteers over the years. Thanks to my current staff, Chris Costello, Callum Jamieson and Katrina Fischenda. Katrina is the chair of the Campaign for Socialism, of which I was the convener for many years. Anne Henderson, who's worked in the Scottish Parliament on and off since 1999, who challenged gender stereotypes as a young woman train driver and more recently as the second ever female rector of Edinburgh Uni. And Leslie Dobbin, who must be one of the longest serving MSP staff members, having worked with me for over two decades and supported me as a friend and colleague. Leslie deserves my thanks on the record for that. And can I take an intervention, or do you wish me to finish?
Well, I was going to say, so I thought people knew this, Mr. Fulton MacGregor, is this really protocol, though not the law, that we try to let people in the last speech go uninterrupted? Oh, no, you didn't. You want to take it. She's such a lady. On you go.
I think, Presiding Officer, you'll now realise why I wanted to get to my feet and say that myself and Elaine, I wanted to, before she finished, put on record another thanks. Myself and Elaine are the only two people in this Parliament so far to have represented Coatbridge and Christ, and we both agree that that is very much the best constituency. And I want to put on record, while she's thanking everybody, my thanks to her, because I've come to really respect her. I always respected her for the work she'd done in the constituency, but I've come to really respect her over the last 5 years and the work she does. And it's fitting that she ends in such a powerful speech about women like she has done, and she's always fighting that. So I want to thank her from the current MSP for all she's done for Coatbridge and Christ since the inception of the Parliament in 1999. And I hope now, Presiding Officer, you understand why I sought to intervene.
You've redeemed yourself, Mr. MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very glad I took that intervention. Thanks very much. So finally, really, a special thanks to my mum Moira, my sister Siobhan, my mother-in-law Rita for all their help, particularly with essential and much-valued childcare, which made it possible for me to be part of this Parliament in the beginning. And last but far from least, my very supportive husband Van and my son Van. It's been an honour and a privilege, as well as a challenge sometimes, to represent my home area of Coatbridge and Cryston and latterly Central Scotland as the Scottish Labour MSP since 1999. And I wish our new leader, Anna Sadwa, my MSP comrades and sisters, and all the MSPs that are standing down, particularly the class of 99, all the best for the future. I'm going to finish with the words of Clara Zetkin, who brought forward the famous motion at the International Conference of Working Women in 1910 so that we could all celebrate women annually on an international basis. Clara said, "The vote for women will unite our strength in the struggle for socialism." Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Now, if all interventions are like that, I see no problem in people taking them. I now call Alison Johnson, please, to open for the Green Party. Ms. Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The theme of this year's International Women's Day is really thought-provoking and motivating. Choose to challenge. And those of us privileged enough to be in Parliament have a duty to challenge. There's a real responsibility on those of us with the privilege of choice to use it. But of course, even in 2021, fewer than 25% of parliamentarians around the world are women. In the face of such glacial progress, we must choose to challenge any and all systems that perpetuate such underrepresentation. Trump may be gone, but his disgusting macho politics hasn't. His misogynistic language was common knowledge before he became president, and the same applies to Brazil's President Bolsonaro. When so-called leaders normalise misogynistic language and behaviour, there is no choice. We must challenge it. Let's choose to challenge a system that means that women in Venezuela and around the globe can't afford contraception. That's a system that makes it very hard for women to choose to challenge. It's a system that deprives women of agency and choice. Choose to challenge a system that sees too many women's sports receive a fraction of the media coverage of their male counterparts, and therefore a fraction of the opportunities to earn through endorsements and advertising. While hosting the London Games as mayor, Boris Johnston is widely reported to have said, "There are semi-naked female beach volleyball players glistening like wet otters." Women's athleticism, ability, skill and success is so often totally overlooked, and the focus on how women look, not what they do, persists. So let's choose to challenge the invisibility of women's achievements past and present. Choose to challenge the proliferation of statues of male slave owners and the lack of acclaim and acknowledgement of women who have excelled in many humanitarian endeavours, women like Elsie Ingalls, Frances Melville and Flora Murray. Briefly.
Elaine Smith.
Thank you very much. I think you thought I'd had the last word there. But I noticed on my way down the hill that all of the quotes outside on the wall of Parliament are mainly by men. There's one by a woman, so maybe this Parliament could think about that too.
It's a point, a point very well made, Elaine Murray. Thank you, and I agree wholeheartedly. I think it's true that, as the Cabinet Secretary said in opening, in many ways it's taken a pandemic for us to recognise the brilliant women in our midst. Nurses make up 42% of the NHS workforce. Almost 80% of nurses are women. 85% of the social care workforce are women. These incredible women have played a major part in Scotland's efforts to challenge COVID-19. Their work day in, day out, long before the pandemic, is always challenging health inequality and ensuring that each patient and person they work with receives the best of care. We need to properly value and pay them. Professor Linda Bald and Professor Devi Sridhar, they have become household names. They've been the voices of calm expertise and reason that we've all come to rely on. Let's choose to challenge the fact that this Parliament has a long way to go and work to do to properly represent the people of Scotland. Challenge the lack of women here and in local government across the country. Challenge the way things are done when this means that women who have been involved in politics feel that they have to leave because they can't spend enough time with their children and loved ones. Challenge the timings of meetings that mean that those with caring duties can't attend. Yes, overwhelmingly women. Challenge the fact that single parents, of whom 92% are women, can't go to the pub to do the networking that makes promotion or indeed political selection more likely. Choose to challenge the shameful fact that we live in a country where proof of rape is required to receive child tax credits for a third child. Choose to challenge the discrimination, bullying and harassment that women of colour, LGBTQ women, disabled women and refugee women face in the workplace, as well as the multiple barriers that prevent them from entering the labour market in the first place. In many instances, women are taking on unpaid work on top of their paid employment, but too often this isn't recognised or appreciated or even noticed, because that type of work isn't valued. It's not even viewed as work, despite the huge contribution women's unpaid labour makes to the economy. Presiding officer, the term second shift was invented by sociologist Arlie Hochschild in the 70s to describe the household and childcare duties that follow a day's work for women. 40 years later, we're still trying to tackle the persistent gender imbalance, which sees women taking on the majority of domestic and care work. Let's choose to challenge this inequality so that we can improve the lives of the women experiencing it today and prevent future generations from having to fight these same battles. In closing, Presiding Officer, I too would like to thank those women who won't be standing again, and to wish you all the very best in all that you go on to do. I know that you will continue to make a difference wherever you are. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Johnson. I now call Beatrice Wishart to open for the Liberal Democrats. Ms Wishart, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Equality is one of the four founding principles of the Scottish Parliament. It should be at the core of everything we do here. And yet, over 20 years into this Parliament, many challenges remain. We undoubtedly still have work to do. In November, we spoke about problems around violence against women, the life-ruining crimes, the hideous harassment, problems that have to be addressed globally and closer to home. I choose to challenge domestic abuse and gender-based violence against women and girls, and I do so frequently. Of course, those are not the only challenges women face. Many have said that the pandemic turned back the clock on gender equality. It's certainly true that negative impacts have fallen disproportionately on women. Job losses and income reductions have been widespread. An International Monetary Fund report highlighted how women are more likely than men to work in social sectors, including retail, tourism and hospitality, where lockdown has been most acutely felt. The true value of care has come into the limelight, both professionally and domestically. And the responsibility to manage schooling at home has, without question, hit women harder. Many people found themselves between a rock and a hard place, juggling impossible burdens and unrealistic expectations. These problems are not new. There's nothing unfamiliar in what I've just described. The relationship between women and work has always been fragile. Often this is because where caring responsibilities naturally fall. As we have just seen during the course of the pandemic, these extra expectations are just supposed to be absorbed. But the working world is full of rigid expectations and counterproductive policies like those being fought by the WASPI women. According to a TUC survey published in January, more than 7 in 10 women who applied for furlough after the latest school closures had their requests turned down. And that forces women to sacrifice pursuing progression. Evidence bears that out. Research by Engender found that representation in positions of power are still dominated by men. Women make up 52% of the Scottish population, yet we only account for 36% of public body chief executives, 13% of senior police officers, 6% of major newspaper editors. There are no women as CEOs of Scottish-based FTSE 100 and 250 companies. Politics sees much of the same. In fact, there are concerns, and I feel they are valid concerns, that gender balance in politics may be going in the wrong direction. Too many women have made the decision to step down explicitly because sitting in Holyrood is incompatible with family life and attracts undue and insufferable abuse. Before the pandemic, a family-friendly parliament amounted to a commitment to avoiding formal business running on into the evenings and a creche on site for staff. And this follows an exodus of women from public office in the run-up to the 2019 general election, which was largely motivated by disgraceful online vitriol that reinforced the clear and urgent need for more to be done to tackle misogynistic harassment. Perhaps this week more than most, it seems as though the political world is not doing enough to ensure that a woman's place is in Parliament. This is where we make laws and set examples. Taking inspiration from this year's International Women's Day theme, I think we can choose to challenge the Parliament to be better than that, to learn the lessons of the last 12 months, make hybrid operation a long-term reality that lets women in rural and non-central belt communities take part and balance family life. Take the opportunity to make things better for the future. This is a moment to change things and we should grasp it. Finally, Presiding Officer, I'd like to express, as others have done, to all the members who are standing down, my good wishes for whatever future your future holds for you.
Thank you very much. I now open debate. Now call Ruth Maguire, to be followed by Jeremy Balfour. Ms. Maguire.
Presiding Officer, choose to challenge is the theme for this year's International Women's Day. Challenge is healthy, helpful, and when constructive and persistent, it's ultimately what gets things done. From challenge comes change. And challenge always helps us make better decisions. Challenge is necessary. I get the appeal of consensus, of compliance, of conformity, of not making a fuss. Consensus is comfortable. But make no mistake, consensus is most valuable when it's arrived at after debate, discussion, and yes, challenge. And when that happens, it's worth substantially more than the warm, cosy feeling that being surrounded only with those of the same mind as our own gives. So let me salute challenging women, and in particular, those who are leaving our parliament. The women who persistently speak out for women and girls, even when doing so is difficult, uncomfortable, and comes at a cost, because in doing so, they're accused of not caring about others, or worse, of harming others. Let me commend women who have different beliefs, different political or philosophical positions, but come together and respectfully and honestly work for a shared goal. I want to acknowledge women who centre women and girls in the work that they do. Women who campaign and fight against the persisting injustices women face in this stubbornly persistent patriarchal society. Injustices such as the undervaluing of care, both paid and unpaid, predominantly carried out by women. Pregnancy and maternity discrimination, the gender pay gap, and limiting sexist stereotypes. I want to acknowledge and applaud women who campaign to end male violence against women in all its forms, sexual harassment, domestic abuse, female genital mutilation, so-called honour crimes, sexual assault, rape, trafficking, stalking and prostitution. I thank women like Elaine Smith who understand that women's liberation is not complete and the world right now is not as safe as it should be for women and girls, and it's certainly not equal. And I want to particularly acknowledge older women who spent decades fighting and to who we owe a huge debt of gratitude for all they achieved in securing women's rights and freedoms that many of us now take for granted and perhaps sometimes forget had to be fought for. To women who've shared their personal trauma publicly to illustrate the need to uphold women's rights and have been shamefully accused of weaponising their trauma. I understand the toll that takes. I'm sorry that happened to you. Thank you for your strength. I want to celebrate the women in our communities, in our council chambers, in our parliaments, and in our government who put their heads above the parapet and in the face of patronising dismissal, in the face of ridicule, sexism, hostility, and in some cases, in the face of violent, misogynistic abuse and threats of physical harm. Keep going, keep speaking out, keep taking action. I see you all, you make a difference. Solidarity, and thank you, sisters.
Thank you very much, Ms. Maguire. I now call Jeremy Balfour, who will be followed by Gail Ross. Mr. Balfour, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased that I'm able to participate in this important debate to mark International Women's Day. As a father of twin girls, Kezia and Ellie, as they grow up, I want them to live on an equal footing with men. I therefore welcome this year's theme of Choose to Challenge, because if we all choose to call out gender bias and inequality and to celebrate women's achievements, we can help create an inclusive world. The role played by women in Scottish society has changed more in the 20th century than any other time in recorded history. A woman has become fully enfranchised members of society. Today, women contribute significantly to sectors of Scottish life. This week, I'm pleased to support a motion congratulating Deborah Keogh, a resident of Scotland since 2011 and human rights lawyer, on starting her role as rector of the University of Edinburgh, one of the UK's most prestigious institutions. She is the first Black woman, first African immigrant, and the third woman since 1858 to be named rector. I was delighted to read her focused whilst rector or to be challenged inequalities. I hope that role models such as she can help to instill confidence and encourage girls to be aspirational and consider themselves capable of becoming a lawyer, an engineer, an athlete, or even a politician. However, there is still no room for complacency. According to the World Economic Forum, sadly, none of us will see gender parity in our lifetimes, or nor likely will many of our children. There are many inequalities between men and women that are well established. We know women are more likely than men to be out of employment due to caring responsibilities, and more likely to be moving to part-time employment after having a child. Other research on barriers to return to employment has cited lack of suitable jobs, childcare issues, a preference for caring for children, a lack of qualifications and experience, and issues organising transport. Mothers are more likely to sacrifice employment fathers for a variety of reasons, including the fact that fathers often receive a higher salary, as well as social expectations around gender roles. Research has shown that mothers who do return to employment often shift to lower paid jobs, and even if they continue in the same job, are less likely to gain promotion. We also know that this pandemic has made the inequalities even greater. As already been mentioned by a number of speakers, women are more likely to be impacted by job disruption and furlough due to working in a sector such as hospitality and retail. According to the Office for National Statistics, women did 2/3 of additional childcare duties, spent more time on unpaid work and less time on paid work than men during lockdown one. The ONS also shows that women did more cooking and washing than men did and were more likely to be unpaid carers. Certainly from my own experience, I know that is true, not only in my own household, but many of the other parents I talk to in the school playground. These problems are even more acute for single parents, of whom 90% are women. That is why the Scottish Conservatives support the rollout of 1,140 hours of free childcare, and are concerned that this has not been implemented properly by the government. An Order Scotland report published in March 2020 highlighted that with just 5 months remaining, this government still has to recruit half of the required staff and a significant amount of the building infrastructure, which still has to be completed. We also know that in STEM subjects, often women are left behind in regard to these particular areas. We also need to look at the way we work, not only within the Parliament, but as in society generally. I support Equate Scotland's call on government employers and trade unions to capitalise on the benefits lessons and many sacrifices made through COVID-19 to offer more rounded, substantial, flexible working policies and practice, activity promoted to all staff. There are still many issues affecting women's equality that need to be challenged, and we as Conservatives are committed to achieving equality of opportunity for women in all aspects of life. We will continue to work with key stakeholders to ensure that any sexism or discrimination against women is rooted out. Finally, Deputy Presiding Officer, can I also say a fond farewell to many of the lady women MSPs who have been part of this Parliament for many years. It has been a privilege for me to get to know some of them, to work with others closely, and they will be missed across the different parties, and I wish them all well in what happens next in their life. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Balfour. I now call Gail Ross, to be followed by Joanne Lamont. This is Ms. Ross's final speech, I understand. Ms. Ross, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The subject of International Women's Day this year, as we've heard before, is choose to challenge, and challenge I will. In fact, I've been quite challenging all my life, as I'm sure many who know me would agree. Presiding Officer, as you know, politics is a Guy Kerr's game, and it seems to be especially challenging for women. Whatever we do, we have to work twice as hard to be seen as being even half as good. You have to balance having a thick skin with caring, with giving yourself up to the public, but maintaining your privacy. By staying loyal to your party, but having good friends from other parties, with being a person, but still being seen as an object. Being a councillor was a hard job, but being a Member of Parliament is a different thing altogether. It's a tough role, a demanding role, but a rewarding role. And I've been challenged and challenged in return, but the biggest challenge for me, and indeed for some others, as we've heard and we will hear, has been to try and influence or at least educate people on the difficulties of being present in the Scottish Parliament building for so many days every week. So in that sense, Parliament has to have a long, hard look at the way it encourages people, women especially, to become elected members. There has to be more flexibility in work practices. And the remote and virtual working that I was told wasn't possible only a month before we were forced into it by the pandemic has to become the norm. Otherwise, you will get more people like me and others in the chamber today and others who will speak remotely forced into making a decision to either leave or not stand at all. And this is not good for our democracy. Presiding Officer, this parliamentary term, the last 5 years, have been a rich tapestry of experiences, from speaking at the Presiding Officer's Burns Supper to writing poems in the style of Julie Andrews for a Holyrood magazine event. Experiences that have been made all the richer for the people that have surrounded me. And it would not be a final speech without a copious amount of thank yous. And with your indulgence, I would like to personally address these. And I should say that in addition to this list, there are also quite a few men that could be mentioned, but just not today. Firstly, I would like to thank my colleague and friend, Rona Mackay, for giving up her spot in this debate so I could make this my final speech today. My parliamentary team that have been there to support me throughout the good times and bad, they have enabled me to do the job, and I owe you all, past and present members, a huge debt of gratitude. Carrie, she had never worked for an MSP before and is now going on to be a trained councillor, and I'm so proud of her. Kirsteen, you've not had an easy few years, but you've got me to the end, so thank you. And wee Kyla, you've fair cheered up the office since you started, and you're never far from my thoughts. To Christina McKelvey, a champion of equalities and human rights, thank you for believing in me, and I'm thinking of you just now too. To Jean Freeman, she's been mentioned already, for all that she's done, quite simply, thank you. To Emma Harper, we did a great job of bookending the country at every event, agricultural show, meeting. We would tell people how we were working north and south at squeezing the central belt, and we had some success, but some very positive feedback. To our First Minister and my boss, Nicola Sturgeon, she's been an inspiration to me for a lot of years, ever since we had a chance meeting in Glasgow Queen Street Station in the 90s. And then when she asked me to open her event in Eden Court in Inverness, and I misunderstood her text and had to write a speech the night before, but it still went down really well. Being her parliamentary liaison officer and attending FMQ prep was an honour that I don't think I'll ever equal. I never did manage to drop in a question about bus strikes in France, but I still reckon that she can take me out for a lunch whenever she wants. But over the past year, specifically, her commitment and dedication to steering Scotland through this pandemic has been nothing less than superhuman. And I have no doubt that she will lead Scotland to our independence. So thank you, First Minister. And to my two very special friends, the members of my coven, I have more fond words for them, but I've been advised that that sort of language is not advisable in the chamber, and it's already been quite offensive on Twitter, so I'll stop there. But they are, of course, Jenny Gorruth and Marie Goujon. It's a special thing to get to this stage of life and make friends that you wish you'd known years ago. I'll miss our gatherings, making our spells, and I think I've laughed more with them in the last 5 years than the amount of bottles of Prosecco that we've shared. And as you may be aware, Presiding Officer, that turns out to be a lot of laughs. to the security staff, especially Audrey, who helped me clean my dress on the day of the curtaining of Parliament, to Nechra for always stopping for a chat, and to the rest of the hospitality and events team. To every single person that sent me a message of support when I announced I was standing down, to all my friends and colleagues, and to every member of staff. And Presiding Officer, I can't conclude this part of my life without thanking the women in my family. There to pop over with dinners, to put Max to school, to pick him up, to put him to after school clubs, or just be there with support. So,
Granny Mo, Granny Roo, Ruthie and Jacqueline, thank you.
Presiding Officer, I have a confession to make. When I used to sit in the chamber, I would write out a poem that was relevant to the subject being debated and leave it in that desk. I hope when members found them, some made them smile, some made them think. And this is the one that I would leave today if I was in the chamber. No more will you see me, but you know that I'm still there, sat with you in Margot's or passing on the stair. Coffee in the garden lobby just won't be the same. But remember, this is not goodbye, it's just till we meet again. So, Presiding Officer, the question remains, where is a woman's place? Well, a woman's place is in the Scottish Parliament. Best of luck to everyone for whatever the future may bring. Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Ms. Ross. I now call Joanne Lamont, followed by Gillian Martin. Ms. Lamont, please.
Thank you very much for that. I'm not quite sure how I can follow that, but I do want to thank Gail Ross and Elaine Smith, both of whom in their different ways have played quite an important part in my parliamentary life. Gail recently as the Deputy Convener of the Public Petitions Committee, who is probably the good cop most of the time and has been an excellent parliamentarian. And how do you beat that backdrop? That is fantastic. But I am grateful for the opportunity to speak in this debate to mark International Women's Day. And as I near the end of my time in Parliament, I'm mindful of the privilege I've had as an MSP to speak up and speak out for women. Celebrate that women across our communities, celebrate those women across our communities who do that day in and day out. Today is an opportunity to reflect on women's lives and the challenges women have here and globally face because of our sex. Not because of how we look or how we dress, but because of who we are. Across the world, girls face forced marriage, child marriage, female genital mutilation, sex selection, rape in war, denied education, and the independence of action because of their sex. I'm here as a Labour elected member in a party which, from the beginning of this Parliament, understood that women were underrepresented in politics, and that underrepresentation was a consequence of sex discrimination. So I did not and do not take this job lightly. And I'm proud that since its inception, women across the Parliament have taken their work seriously. And no more, I might say, than the persistent and focused Elaine Smith, who we heard earlier today so eloquently speaking up, as she always has done, for women and for those who are disadvantaged. We need to understand fully how being a woman impacts on our health. MESH was mentioned, but MESH, thyroid, other issues for the experience of women has simply not been believed, and it's a feature of women's health that the health system has not understood their experiences. We need to understand how being a woman impacts on our life chances, how job segregation and education and training have lifetime consequences for women. We need to understand women's vulnerability to male violence, that fear of male violence is an ever-present companion since our youth. Anxious while walking home, alert when running in the park, aware too of what behaviour must be managed in the workplace. And of course, the reality of domestic abuse, sexual violence, coercive control and femicide, dominating the lives of all too many women across this country and framing the capacity of women to escape and underlining the need for single-sex spaces where women might heal and learn. Women's lives tell us why we need to invest in public services that see women's needs and the many roles women have in holding families and communities together. Women who are carers, either paid or unpaid. Women managing elderly parents and their children. And now, in the teeth of a pandemic and what is to come, the need to understand that we must test and direct all of our budgets to understand how women are disadvantaged and how women's inequality must be addressed in the coming period. There has been progress, but there is a long way to go, and we all have a responsibility to choose to challenge. My generation chose to challenge the notion that women were absent from positions of power because they were just not good enough, and if you just tried hard enough, you would get on, or that women were uniquely suited to caring and to women's work, or that somehow women deserved what happened to them if they were the victims of male violence. And we also chose to challenge a definition of politics that excluded the experience of women's lives, didn't talk about childcare issues, really didn't talk about low pay, certainly did not talk about abuse and neglect and a systematic denial of women's rights. And now these are areas which are seen as mainstream in political life itself and necessary in anything that's going to address inequality. And now I finish by saying just two last things. When I got involved in politics, when in this Parliament we spoke about women's rights, when my dear departed sister Trish Godwin spoke up about the abuse of women through prostitution and trafficking, a system driven by the needs of men and benefiting men, exploiting, not liberating the most vulnerable women. When my dear friend Maria Fife spoke up about women's rights to choose, the need and importance of women to control their fertility. When women have spoken up about women's inequality, it was because we wanted to change women's lives. I never imagined that I would be fighting at this stage in my life in this Parliament moves not to change women's lives, but to change what the very word women itself means. And so I choose a challenge. Women across the world know what sex discrimination is and what it is to be a woman. And those men who discriminate and against and abuse women know what it is too. And there is a new generation of young women who know this. Young women who feel silenced, not perhaps by arguments about what women's traditional roles were against which we railed, but young women silenced often by men who not only tell them they are wrong about their own lived experience, but that they as men know better. But I am confident that there is a generation of young women who themselves will choose to challenge the shifting sands on which all too many women, and particularly young women, now stand. And on International Women's Day, I and many of my sisters will support them every step of the way as they challenge and they demand the rights as young women, as we have done in the past. On International Women's Day, we celebrate all that women have done and celebrate the optimism of what yet is to happen for women.
Thank you, Ms. Lamont. And I now call Gillian Martin to be followed by Maurice Corrie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As many others have said, the theme of this year's International Women's Day is Choose to Challenge, and it's good to see so many challenging women speaking today. Women that speak truth to power, women that say what needs to be said, even when it's uncomfortable, in fact, sometimes especially because it's uncomfortable. There are those who would rather we challenging women sit down and shut up. There have been folk like that throughout the ages. They exist today. Don't make a fuss, stop banging on, be nice, where's your smile, etc., etc. People who demand women apologise for men's bad behaviour, men who promote only those in their likeness, people who turn a blind eye to inequality because they think it doesn't affect them. And of course, women's inequality does affect them. It stymies the prosperity and the well-being of every society that it stubbornly persists in. Well, let me use my short time to supply some challenges. I promise if we meet them, it will be good for all of us, men and women alike. I challenge this country to do everything they can to close the gender pay gap. I challenge everyone in this country to share caring and housework responsibilities equally between the sexes, not least you, John Martin. I challenge this country to end female sexual exploitation and violence against women in all its forms. I challenge this country to reduce gender segregation in jobs like care, technology, engineering, and science. I challenge every party in this chamber to return 50% men and 50% women representatives in May. I challenge our COVID recovery to prioritise redressing the imbalance of the adverse effect on women and committing to erasing the inequalities that have widened during the pandemic. I challenge respect and consent to be at the core of everything we teach our children about relationships. I challenge everyone to check their misogyny, and while you're at it, challenging anyone else's misogyny as well. And I challenge everyone to stop abusing women online and to take oxygen away from those who do. If we meet these challenges, our economy will thrive. More women will be paying more tax, which will be good for public spending, and our well-being index will soar. Our health outcomes will be better, and better policy decisions will be made that will make life for everyone better. And if that takes being labelled as a difficult woman or a challenging woman to achieve these things, then that suits me just fine. Our society is all the better because of so-called difficult or challenging women throughout our history. Challenging women have certainly made life better for women in Scotland. And this Parliament is set to use some of its most excellent of their number in 3 weeks' time. Women in my party who've inspired and supported so many, including myself, Miss Cunningham, Miss Watt, Miss Freeman, Miss Ross, Miss White, Miss Fabiani, and Miss Campbell, who's here today. And women in other parties who are speaking today, who I've not always agreed with, but who I greatly admire and respect, Miss Lamont, Miss Smith. So, happy International Women's Day, and here's to women who challenge. Where on earth would we be without you?
Thank you very much, Ms. Martin. Now, call Maurice Corrie, to be followed by Emma Harper. Mr. Corrie, please.
Deputy Presiding Officer, it is indeed a privilege, as a father of three daughters, to join in this debate today and celebrate this very important upcoming International Women's Day next week. It is indeed fortuitous that this is also Fair Trade Fortnight, and where women provide a large part of the workforce in the developing world, and indeed in the British Commonwealth, in which I have an interest through the Scottish Parliament's branch of the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association. This year's campaign theme speaks of the responsibility each of us shares to celebrate women's achievements by doing all we can to promote greater visibility and opportunity, choosing not only to recognise but challenge the stereotypes and limitations we see in society. International Women's Day is a collective drive, resting on all our shoulders, and to call for greater inclusion. And not only should we challenge others in raising women's equality, but we should also prepare to be challenged ourselves, whether at home or in the workplace, in public or in private, to tackle gender bias and indeed inequality, no matter how subtle or small. While progress has been made, it is clear that it is still a long way to go, and according to Close the Gap, most low-paid and often precarious work tends to be taken up by women, many of whom consistently need to balance both earning and caring responsibilities. Instances of racism, prejudice and discrimination remain worryingly common and to continue disproportionately impact women. Internationally, we hear of appalling reports of young schoolgirls continuing to be kidnapped in northern Nigeria, issues for women in other parts of the world, and now countries in the part of the Arabian Peninsula. My time spent working overseas in countries recovering from civil wars, such as Bosnia, Croatia, Kosovo, and Afghanistan, I have seen on the ground for real the hardship women have endured to just keep their families together, fed and watered, where they themselves in Afghanistan particularly were being denied education in past years. Turning back to here at home, the impact of COVID-19 has been far-reaching. However, we cannot ignore the effect it has had on women. Disruption to work has been widespread. This has affected women more keenly. Indeed, the vast majority of frontline workers are women, which means that they face greater risk to their physical and mental well-being as they continue to deliver essential services in the most challenging of circumstances. Moreover, the sectors which tend to be dominated by female workers, such as retail, tourism and hospitality, had suffered heavy losses, resulting in damaging knock-on effects for women. Through the many months of homeschooling and increased childcare, the pressure on women to reduce their work hours has been more pronounced. It is vital that gains made in furthering gender equality are not reversed, and global data from UN Women has warned that the pandemic could be responsible for wiping out 25 years of progress. To conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, I believe there is a renewed urgency to this year's International Women's Day. We need to challenge the barriers women face and answer these calls with real, significant, lasting action. The pandemic has spotlighted the real risk in undervaluing women and the obligation for all of us, policymakers or not, to ensure that ground gain has not been lost. And may I now finally wish all our lady members well as they leave this Parliament. We shall miss their style, their flair, their good humour, their intellect, and simply we shall miss you all. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Corrie. I call Emma Harper, the last speaker in the open debate. Ms. Harper, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak today to mark International Women's Day on March the 8th, which, as colleagues have described this year's theme, is Choose to Challenge. This pandemic has certainly caused many challenges for women in Scotland and across the world, and I appreciate the impact that COVID has had on women, and that has been highlighted across Chamber this afternoon with some pretty awesome contributions from the Sisters and the Brothers Tay. A challenged world is an alert world, and from challenge comes change. So let's all choose to challenge and support rights and freedoms and tackle misogyny. As noted by the United Nations, individually, we're all responsible for our own thoughts and actions all day, every day. Everyone has the choice to challenge stereotypes. We can choose to challenge and fight bias. We can broaden perceptions, improve situations, and celebrate the achievements of women, many of them in this Parliament today. It is important for us all to work to enable this to happen and to strive for empowerment and equality. Presiding Officer, members may recall that in January last year, I brought a debate forward on United Nations Resolution 1325 on women, peace and security. Resolution 1325 was passed unanimously by the United Nations Security Council. It was the first resolution of its kind with the aim of specifically addressing the impact of war on women and the value of women in conflict resolution and as conflict resolvers and of women who choose to challenge conflict, hatred and discrimination. The Scottish Government's Equally Safe policy is the principle that all women and girls, regardless of background, race, religion or sexual orientation, should feel safe in their communities and should feel empowered to take any opportunities and call out challenge, discrimination or hatred. Indeed, internationally, Scotland, working in partnership with the UN, has pledged practical and financial support for women and girls to achieve this goal and to learn peace-building and conflict resolution skills. And in so doing, women and girls will feel confident to challenge war and intolerance. In the Scottish Government and UN programme, which runs over 3 days and consists of talks, seminars and lessons, women and girls have access to international peacekeeping experts, female role models in positions of power, and have the opportunity to learn from each other. This includes about the fundamentals of peacekeeping, of challenging intolerance, and on building consensus. This has proved to have a lasting and positive impact on the individuals who take part on and on the future of many war-affected areas across the world, and has hugely benefited Syria. Presiding Officer, our First Minister was the first world leader to address the UN General Assembly, discuss the importance of women playing our part both at home and internationally. The First Minister spoke of the importance of societies and countries having a focus on welfare and of peace promotion and of an environment in which women can challenge stereotypes and promote tolerance. There are many other ways in which this Scottish Government is promoting gender equality and the promotion and empowerment of women. We have a gender balanced cabinet, equal representation on our public boards. All residents living in Scotland have the right to vote in Scottish elections, including those women with leave to remain. Women in Scotland can stand for this Parliament, and it is important to note that Scotland has a dedicated Minister for Equalities and a commitment to upholding women's rights. Presiding Officer, in closing, I would again like to pay tribute to the work the Scottish Government is undertaking, through introduction of legislation and policies, through a wellbeing approach to government to tackle gender equality and to empower women to challenge stereotypes and be the best they can be. Through challenge comes change, Presiding Officer. Hashtag challenge to change. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Harper. Closing speeches, and I'll call on Polly McNeill to close for Labour. Ms McNeill, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today's a sad day in many ways. Women's equality has rolled back considerably because of the pandemic. Women reverting back to caring roles, taking the brunt of homeschooling and childcare. As Shirley Ann Somerville says in her opening, I'd like to endorse this by thanking all the women who've taken on this role in all of our lives, and in my own family too, the girls, which I do worry about because I do think they'll be further disadvantaged by a lack of school, and that's a challenge for all of us. A recent Mumsnet survey of 1,500 women found that 79% agreed that the responsibility of homeschooling fell largely to me, and the vast majority agreed that it was impossible for me to work uninterrupted when the schools closed. I believe that women do need to be more strident, stronger than ever. It's not a choice to challenge, as far as I'm concerned, but a necessity to challenge because of the pandemic times. And nearly three quarters of working mothers who applied for furlough through the latest school closures had their requests turned down, who have family-friendly issues in our working environment. I believe it's our primary challenge as women legislators to recognise this and act on it in the next Parliament. But it's also sad because, as we've heard this afternoon, that we have some incredible women MSPs who are standing down, and from all parties. Some because they've served very long shifts, but others because the job of an MSP can compromise family life. I want to talk a wee bit about my Labour sisters. Jenny Mara, a woman who's made a huge contribution, a young talent, a radical voice for Dundee, I think, is a loss to her party and a loss to the Parliament. And as you've heard there, the wonderful Gail Ross, a bright, funny, easygoing person, and we've been hearing from Gail over the months about perhaps a revision of family-friendly policies. And Aileen Campbell, a great minister who I think has earned the respect of all the parties. I know she's standing down before our time. I'd like to wish her well in the times ahead. When I think of the early days in this place, as I too came in 99, but I had a period out, many women struggling with young families, trying to find their feet. Childcare was an issue back then too. I think about my dear friend Karen Gillan, who had her three children in office, and she had the office next to me. We loved it. There was always a baby in a pram, especially Joanne. Absolutely loved to come and visit us because she liked to attend to the baby. But Shirley Ann Somerville is right. I think it was she who said this. We might have hyped up just how family-friendly our Parliament was. Perhaps we just lost our way. And I'd say this even in my own life. I married in 1999, virtually the year I got elected. My husband was shocked at the long hours that I spent away from home. I was a Glasgow MSP, still am, have no children. So I can only imagine what it's like trying to bring up a young family. And I'm sure that's true of young fathers too. I'm already surmising that it's no wonder that many women MSPs don't want to come here, and their percentage has dropped to 34%. Another Labour sister, Joanne Lamb, who has just spoken in the way that she always does, with absolute fierceness and absolute belief. I remember Joanne when she was a minister. She'd tell me that she'd sit with her red box at 6 a.m. at the poolside as her son, a champion at swimmer, so that she could make sure that he did not lose out. Her feminism she brought to her ministerial post. She is funny as she is feisty, continually arguing for sex-based rights for women. What a difference, Joanne, you have made to this Parliament. And we've heard from the wonderful Elaine Smith, not frightened of anyone or anything, a huge amount of integrity. I always know that if Elaine raises a point of order, it's going to be very thorough and it's going to be a really pointed one. She championed the breastfeeding bill, she championed food justice bill in the Parliament more recently. She's been a really strong voice in this place. She will be missed. And Mary Fee, who's not here, has a huge amount of respect for the work that she's done on justice and equality. And in fact, when I first met Mary in my first days here, she had the most folders of any MSP I ever met because of the many committees that Mary served on. But I would want to pay tribute to Rosanna Cunningham, Jean Freeman, Maureen Watt, Linda Famiani, Margaret Mitchell and Ruth Davison, who are all leaving this place. And lastly, Sandra White, which I always found really how funny life is, that when we competed for Glasgow Kelvin, I served the first three terms, she served the last two terms. Never did I think that her and I would be sharing a berth boat on the Mediterranean over a 14-hour journey to break the siege on Gaza. And I'll never forget when I said to her, I feel so seasick, Sandra. If I don't come back in 15 minutes' time, would you make sure that there's not a by-election? So it's funny how life turns out. More to be written about that, I'm sure. But to be serious, when Engender wrote in their publication, Gender Matters, Emma Ritchie wrote, it's an exciting thing to be a feminist. And imagine in 2030 where all the women might be having access to power, resources and safety. But little did she know, little did we know that there would be an intervention, a national pandemic that would halt our plans to reach that target. I think I probably have to wind up, Presiding Officer, in my closing remarks. I don't realise it would take so long. I just wanted to finish
on
this.
You can continue. I'm enjoying this.
Thank you very much. I think it's really important to recognise that we have lost some time in the work that we might have done had there not been a national pandemic. So I think that it's incumbent on whoever is returned to the Parliament, whoever government is returned, to make sure that women's rights and family-friendly policies are at the very heart of our next Parliament's work. Because we know and we all agree that the care sector women make up a vast majority of care workers. And it's time to call this out, because it is ingrained sex discrimination. We can start by paying those workers £15 an hour when we know it's only the beginning. Women's equality is a global issue, and it is very depressing to learn that violence against women by men is still a global issue that we really would concern and depress us. I followed closely the murder and rape of women like Libby Squire in Sheffield. A perpetrator, by his own admission, was looking for a woman to have easy sex with and preyed on her as she made her way home. It demonstrates that violence is a sex-based crime. Presiding Officer, women's safety is as live an issue as it was 40 or 50 years ago. I conclude by paying tribute to all the women who have served in this Parliament and to the wonderful speeches on International Women's Day. I never, ever let down by Gillian Martin or Ruth Maguire in these debates. We must make sure that as women, that we are strong voices, that the rolling back of our achievements and our rights is something we'll catch up on in the next Parliament. And I wish you all well on International Women's Day. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Liz McNeill. I now call Alison Harris to close for the Conservatives, and I believe this is your final speech, Ms Harris.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's a privilege to be closing today for the Conservatives, and it's quite fitting that my last speech in the Chamber will be to mark International Women's Day, and in particular this year's theme of hashtag Choose to Challenge. This year's theme, as I have mentioned, is Choose to Challenge, which urges people to call out and challenge gender bias and inequality women face. A challenged world is an alert world, and from challenge comes change. Individually, we are all responsible for our own thoughts and actions all day, every day. Deputy Presiding Officer, this is the first time throughout my time in the Scottish Parliament that I've actually heard anyone refer to the word responsible or allude to personal responsibility. In this Parliament, we're so used to hearing about the rights of individuals. Yet, if we all balanced our rights with responsibilities, then perhaps, I think, along with more work, the gender bias and inequality that surrounds us all through all walks of life would become less prevalent. We've heard some fantastic contributions this afternoon, and I think it's safe to say that we all agree on the importance of achieving equality and making Scotland a world leader when it comes to women's rights. A year on since I last took part in International Women's Day, and since that day, so much has changed in the world, more than any of us could have ever imagined. But the core challenges facing women at home and abroad remain much the same. And because of the COVID-19 pandemic, in some cases, the challenges have even intensified. Of course, some progress has been made. Of that, there is no doubt. The gender balance in the workplace is improving all the time. The pay gaps between men and women are narrowing, and females are feeling more empowered to speak out about the issues they face. But there's still so much work to do. Perhaps the founders of this important movement would be disappointed to learn there is still even a need to have these conversations more than a century on from its creation. When I look back at the very early contributions on this issue, from when the meetings and marches started more than 100 years ago, I often wonder what those brave and trailblazing women would make of the situation we have today. Even looking around this chamber, on the occasions where it is full, we can see there's more work to do. We've got very good at talking about this issue, but perhaps less good at ensuring change actually happens. Where do we start? Perhaps we need to go back to when our children are young. How often do we hear from parents and teachers that girls develop quicker, mature faster, and perform better in the early years of school? And at what point does that change, and why? Why does that advantage peel away and go into reverse by the time it comes to getting into the workplace? It just underlines that we need to do more than address issues in the workplace. We need to start ensuring equality becomes the norm from a far earlier stage. This year, the theme of International Women's Day is challenging, not just women to do the best they can, but also men to act and call out discrimination when they see it happening. Choose to Challenge is a great theme to have, and I think it should be an everyday theme and not just the theme for 2021. Deputy Presiding Officer, there have been many inspirational quotes shared as we lead up to International Women's Day. One which I read this week from a pioneering sportswoman and leading voice of the feminist movement, Billie Jean King, was, and I quote, "I have long said that women have been conditioned to want less. Women are supposed to be happy with the crumbs, but we deserve the cake, the icing, and the cherry on top." Let's all use that as motivation to work together and ensure that by the next time this debate is held in Parliament, there will be much to celebrate. Deputy Presiding Officer, can I thank all those from across the chamber and virtually who have taken part in this year's debate? I won't be involved in next year's debate. However, this afternoon, let's celebrate females from across the globe. This session of the Scottish Parliament has been exceptionally interesting and a very challenging time to have been involved in politics. And on a more personal level, over the past 5 years, Choose to Challenge has certainly featured in my daily parliamentary life. Over my time in Parliament, there have been so many highlights that will always remain with me. It has been a privilege and an honour serving the people of Central Scotland region as a Scottish Conservative, especially those in my hometown of Falkirk. I would also like to put on record my thanks to all the committee clerks and staff throughout the entire building who worked so tirelessly to try and make life as easy as possible. I also want to thank my staff members, and in particular, a special thanks goes to the other A in my office, namely Aris. Aris has been my right-hand woman throughout this journey. Can I also thank my family and friends, because without their love and support, I wouldn't be able to have risen to this challenge. Can I simply close now, Deputy Presiding Officer, by raising my hand high to show that I am committed to Choose to Challenge. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Harris. I now close on Aileen Campbell to close for the Scottish Government. Cabinet Secretary, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and it's with mixed emotions that I rise to close this debate for the Government. I'm pleased and proud to conclude a debate that has shown the Parliament at its best. Powerful, thoughtful, considered and passionate speeches from women who have contributed a great deal to the betterment of our country. Women who, regardless of their party, have by their very presence here as MSPs chosen to challenge gender inequality. Because despite over 100 years of having the franchise, and despite many equality acts, women still continue to be underrepresented in parliaments around the world, including this one. But I'm also sad, as this represents one of my last contributions in a government debate as an MSP and government minister, and draws ever closer an end to my 14 years here as an MSP representing Clydesdale and the south of Scotland. So during this debate, I want to use my time to reflect achievements delivered by this government, this parliament, and by female parliamentarians, and also to think about the future, how we lay foundations for the next set of MSPs to build from, to empower the next generation of female parliamentarians to realise that a woman's place most definitely is in the parliament. And a debate like this, just before a parliamentary session draws to an election, does give us the chance to reflect and to look back. Look back to what has been achieved and to hopefully feel that we have collectively chosen to challenge enough to ensure that the parliament that we leave behind for the next generation of MSPs has made the positive difference that our country deserves. But that is not to make this debate a moment where we collectively pat each other on the back. We've heard this afternoon too much is still to be achieved, too much still needs to be challenged, and too much work is still required for us ever to think that we can sit back and relax. International Women's Day demands that we, as women in privileged roles of leadership, relentlessly pursue equality, agitate for change, and make the difference. And the positive changes this session have been plenty. In March 2020, the Scottish Parliament unanimously passed the Female Genital Mutilation Act. The Scottish Government is implementing the ambitious recommendations of the First Minister's National Advisory Council on Women and Girls. The Gender Representation on Public Boards Act was passed that sets a gender representation objective for a public board that 50% of its non-executive members are women. Scotland's Cabinet continues to have an equal number of women and men in the government. And our programme for government reaffirmed our commitment to women's health and the development of a women's health plan. And within my portfolio, I've worked with Monica Lennon to lock in the work and world-leading progress that we have made on tackling period dignity through supporting her bill through Parliament. As a country, we had already rolled out free period products nationally for those on low incomes, implemented free period products in education establishments around the country, enabled local authorities to ensure products are available within communities, and we've sought to tackle the stigma and embarrassment around having your period. And her act gives our approach legislative underpinning. Now, I've outlined a range of policies and new laws designed to protect and make women a better women's position in society, along with initiatives to help guide us to do more. This list, Presiding Officer, has been largely delivered by female parliamentarians, illustrating the importance of the need for women to be in this institution and political institutions around the world to help shape and make more representative the decision-making. But while there is a lot to be proud about, we are not quite yet able to say job done, and this last year of the pandemic has exposed the deeply entrenched and systemic inequalities that exist and persist in our society, despite best efforts. The impact of the pandemic has touched us all, but not equally. The Social Renewal Advisory Board noted in its report that the pandemic that we may be all in the same storm, but we are all in different boats. And even then, too many of us are with no boat at all. Disabled people, minority ethnic communities, people on low incomes, older people, younger people, and women are amongst those who have experienced disproportionate impacts, with multiple disadvantage making things even harder for many. Staying at home was fine if you had a safe, secure and warm home. It was made easier if you had a garden and plenty of space. Working from home was fine if you had a white-collar job that enabled you to do so. Less easy if you worked in a factory or your job depended on you being there in person. And homeschooling would be more manageable if you could rely on the support of a partner, less straightforward if you were a single parent shouldering all the work, care and educational responsibilities. Domestic abuse, job uncertainty and shouldering a disproportionate burden of care are just some of the ways in which women the world over have been impacted by the restrictions that were so necessary to deal with the pandemic. And that is why we have sought to ensure that our approach in Scotland has recognised that uncomfortable truth, whether through providing support and funding to organisations tackling domestic abuse or through prioritising the reopening of early learning and childcare settings to children and progressing our commitment to provide 1140 hours of free childcare, in the knowledge that this will essentially, though not exclusively, help support women in their caring roles. It's why we've also provided additional support during the pandemic for unpaid carers, where we know around 60% of whom are women are a fundamental part of our social care system, and have set out in the budget ways in which we intend to go further. That also includes examining the structure of how care is provided and how it's valued as a society through the review of social care. So as we emerge from this pandemic, it's important that we don't allow the impact of the pandemic to set back women's rights or see any regression in those rights. It doesn't need to be like that, and therefore we face a choice. Do we revert back to a pre-pandemic normality, a normality that has failed too many for too long, or do we choose something different? Do we want to choose to challenge the assumption that gender bias is to be tolerated and instead work even harder to reform what we do and renew what we are? If it's the latter, then that will require us to work in a different way and in a collective way. To disregard the hostile politics, or as Gail Ross described it, the Guy Coors politics that has so dominated this last session in the Chamber and online. For women, or indeed anyone, to look at how brutal and aggressive politics has become, they would be forgiven for wanting to give it a wide berth. The result of that will be the continuation of a poorer politics and an unnecessary limit placed on the voices that we have in this chamber, who would otherwise have helped shape the future path of our country. We need to challenge that, and the country will need politicians who are able and willing to work together, and the country's recovery will be determined upon it. So we have a good starting point, the Social Renewal Board that Shirley Ann Somerville and I established to help guide and advise government on how to navigate a recovery path for Scotland that leads us towards equality and fairness, has provided us with ideas and possible solutions to tackle the entrenched and systemic inequality that the country faces. Their calls for action aim to ensure that as we emerge from the pandemic, we could do so in a way that enables us to rebuild and renew with social justice, equality and human rights at the heart. While some colleagues will not be here after the election to continue to drive forward this work, it doesn't mean that we stop caring or somehow turn off our aspirations for our country. The work to create a better Scotland does not begin and end in this chamber. It requires the engagement and involvement of the people and communities that we are all privileged to represent. The recent citizens' assemblies and the inspiring community response to the pandemic shows the assets and the skills that we have across our country. And we are wise to remember that while people are at the moment no longer able to gather in the chamber to look over and judge our work, they remain sovereign and are able to judge us on our conduct. They want their parliamentarians working together, scrutinising and robustly holding government to account, but respectful of difference. And it's a pity that the collaborative work that goes on in this Parliament is often what goes on unnoticed, because it doesn't drive the headlines or get thousands of likes on Twitter. And perhaps one of the things that I'd like to challenge this International Women's Day is that narrative. A narrative that somehow assumes politics needs to be aggressive, that it needs to play the woman or man and not the ball, and that to be a good politician, you need to be bullish, bordering on rude. Of course you need a thick skin. We enter this game with our eyes wide open, but we risk losing the very essence of what this Parliament was set up to do, to bring democracy closer to our people, driven by compassion and driven by kindness. And in large part, today's debate has shown what is achievable when debate is respectful, searching, and the right space is created for free-flowing exchanges of ideas. And I will miss so many who have taken part today, along with the immediate colleagues of my own party, and I pay tribute to them all for what they've contributed, what they've achieved, and how they have advanced women's representation in Scotland's body politic. And to whoever the new female parliamentarians may be that will sit in this chamber in just a few months' time, my advice to you is to choose to do your politics how you want to. Don't feel you need to ape or copy the worst examples of adversarial debate. Instead, know that one of the best ways we can attract a diversity of voice in this chamber to tackle the persistent imbalance in terms of female parliamentarians is to make it a place that people want to be part of, not somewhere you feel threatened. Kindness in politics has never mattered more, and I've been blessed to have served alongside kind, committed parliamentarians and so many of you here today. So thank you to everyone who's made my privileged time in this Parliament so enjoyable and memorable. Best wishes to all my fellow MSPs who are not seeking re-election this May. While I know that we are stepping back from frontline politics, I know that we'll not be stepping back from continuing to choose to challenge. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. And that concludes our debate on International Women's Day 2021. It's now time to move on to the next item of business. There are two questions today. The first question is that motion 24057... Sorry, before we do, I'm conscious that we're actually well ahead of time, so I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now. Could I invite Graeme Dean of the Bureau to move such a motion? Thank you very much. So the question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Thank you. So the first question this evening is that motion 24057 in the name of Gordon Lyndhurst on the pre-release access to official statistics bill be agreed. But because this is legislation, we will need to suspend for a few moments to allow all members to access the voting app. So I'm going to suspend for a few moments. Thank you. That's us back in public session. We're going to go straight to the vote. So the question is that motion 24057 in the name of Gordon Lyndhurst on pre-release access to official statistics Scotland bill be agreed. Members should cast their votes now. This is a 1 minute division. Thank you. That vote is now closed. Please let me know if you had any difficulties in voting. Can I call Tom Mason to make a point of order? Tom Mason.
Yes, presiding officer. Hello?
Mr. Mason, we can hear you. Thank you.
Yes, I've had a problem with my app. I would cast my vote yes.
Thank you, Mr. Mason. You would have voted yes. I will make sure your vote is added to the voting register. The result of the vote on motion 24057 in the name of Gordon Lyndhurst is yes 62, there were no votes against, there were 56 abstentions. The motion is agreed and the pre-release access to Official Statistics Scotland Bill is passed. Our next question is that motion 24038 in the name of Bill Kidd on Scottish Parliamentary Standards Sexual Harassment and Complaints Process Bill be agreed. Members should cast their votes now. Again, this will be a 1 minute division. 1 minute on the Scottish Parliamentary Standards Sexual Harassment and Complaints Process Bill. That vote is now closed. Please let me know if you had any difficulty in voting. And could I call Tom Mason to make a point of order? Tom Mason.
Presiding officer, the same problem. I would have voted yes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mason. I'll make sure that your vote yes is added to the register. Thank you. The result of the vote on motion 24038 in the name of Bill Kidd is yes 119. There were no votes against, there were no abstentions, the motion is agreed and the Scottish Parliamentary Standards Sexual Harassment and Complaints Process Bill is passed. Thank you, colleagues. That concludes decision time. I close this meeting.